Erste Regel.
They did warn us, Paso Doble. But by that point, they had already succumbed to the fate of lovers, and with their distorted voices, glittery hair, and shiny foil earrings, they wanted to become the thing they desired. The love story between humans and robots is a long one. For Professor Kokelberg, from the University of Vienna, one thing is clear. Allegedly, cold robots are profoundly romantically inclined.
We see technology and romanticism as two different things because we put robots in the category of technology and science, and we put the romanticism in the category of literature, arts, and so on. My book, New Romantic Cyborgs, tries to cut through that distinction between culture and technology by saying that the way we use our artifacts, such as robots, that it's also that we use them in a romantic way. And romantic can literally refer, of course, to matters of love, but it can also refer to more broadly, as I do in the book, to more what romanticism was in the 19th century. For example, looking for the wondrous and the mysterious. It makes me think about the history of automata, where you also have demonstrations, where there comes a professor who is almost like a kind of magician and brings an automaton to show to the people, and the automaton does all kind of tricks. And or sometimes it was just a human hiding in the machine, but sometimes it was also machines. And I think we have a lot of that going on today when roboticists showcase their robots. The world is not disenchanted, and therefore it's also really not necessary to re-enchant it. So it's a whole romanticism and what it reacts to, a sort of cold rationalist enlightenment. Both are caricatures and are not really corresponding to the world as it is.
Her early work was with a Moog synthesizer. Though it's a museum piece now, when it was first introduced, it opened the door to a world of music synthesis.
There was a time when this romantic sensibility pointed to a bright future, a queer utopia thanks to technology. Here, for example, designed by trans woman Wendy Carlos, pioneer of electronic music. Or in Donna Haraway's Cyborg Manifest, which returns in the form of hybrid bodies in Björk's music video. As time flies by, technologies have become more modern and their supporters increasingly conservative.
I think that the idea of robots as this very binary and heterosexual portrayal has very long origins that go way back into the stories we tell about creating artificial partners. And even though there's a really early story from the Greek, a myth about a woman whose husband dies and she creates a substitute husband and she takes him to bed with her, this creation, this artificial partner, predominantly the stories that come after that all tend to have a woman as the perfect artificial being. And you can think of things like Pygmalion, the story from the Roman poet Ovid about the man who created his beautiful wife as a statue and then brought her to life. So I think we're fed these narratives over many centuries that it is possible to create the perfect partner and she is subject to control and it is very gendered. So the idea that you can create a biddable, programmable woman who will do the things that you tell her to, there's a lot tied in there with patriarchy and with sexism. At the moment, there aren't really any sex robots out there in the world. There's just prototypes made in a handful of workshops, but they all tend to be based on the sex doll. And the sex doll market is predominantly aimed at straight men. So it will have very reductive stereotypes of the female body. These are dolls that are life-size with very narrow waists and large breasts and long legs. And you know, that's just the same kind of a negative body image that is being pushed on women by the media all the time.
Pop culture is full of fembots who get dangerous, like that much-copied figure in pink lingerie in Austin Powers' International Man of Mystery by Jay Roach. Women who team up are, of course, dangerous for the patriarchy. They develop their own will and outwit their creators, usually with erotic tricks, How outrageous.
Is it cold in here?
Yet these fembots, whilst always depicted as hot, end up being burned alive, like many self-determined women since the persecution of witches. The male terror of liberated sex bots is in truth the genderized variant of the fear that a suppressed species could one day outwit us. In the romantically inspired Frankenstein model portrayed here in a 1931 film, again as head-to-head combat, the robot seeks revenge for having been neglected, as we can see today, for example, in Ex Machina.
Hallo. Ist es seltsam, etwas erschaffen zu haben, das dich hasst?
Was hast du mit Eva gemacht?
So, have the fictional accounts maybe led us somewhat into confusion? Or into clarity? Because they peddle all the omnipresent old narratives?
Универсальный рабочий!
From this chivalrous production of RUR to the resolutely pink-clad, yearning romantic Jonathan and his beloved disembodied female.
Hallo, da bin ich.
Hi.
Hi, ich bin Samantha.
From the erotic robot, as a modernized Snow White figure in Prometheus, to the hard outside, soft inside woman in the somewhat subversive conquest film, I'm Your Man, that quotes dialogues, scene images and scripts from romantic comedy.
Das ist etwas, wovon 93% der deutschen Frauen träumen.
Dann kommst du vielleicht selber drauf, zu welcher Gruppe ich gehöre.
Zu den 7%?
Even though it's no longer possible to use eloquent biologistic arguments about the naturalness of robots to smooth everything over.
Robots are never just artifacts, but are always related to bigger forms of life and games. I call them technology games, and so inspired by Wittgenstein, I developed this kind of model to understand technology in a more cultural way. And like this, I can understand also robots, for example, sex robots, as being connected to these kind of binary games and this kind of stereotypical patterns. But for that, we first have to realize that the robots are political and are ethically relevant and are also cultural artifacts.
If you think about the way that sex toys have changed over time, they used to be incredibly limited to resembling genitalia, for example. So you would have sex toys that looked like a penis, for example. But then in the past kind of 20, 30 years, those have changed. They've become more abstracted. They've become things that are actually objects of beauty and of art. And if we can do that with things like sex toys, can we do that with our robotics as well? And perhaps we can move into a more design-led phase where we see changes. So who's to say that your sex robot couldn't be a giant cushion with arms that can hug you and sensors that can caress you? Or perhaps it takes the form of a robot with a screen where you can read erotic stories or watch porn. So there are many things that break this idea of having just a replica human.
Of course, it's just the start of a new logic, but it wouldn't be the first time that a sexual encounter develops into something more, after all. Like in Sweet Love by Bilderbuch.
Hello and welcome everyone, and I hope that film has whet your appetite for this evening's final panel. Robots in Love, AI in Popular Culture, to which I am very pleased to welcome Dr. Kate Devlin and Professor Despina Kakoudaki joining me as two very esteemed colleagues famous for their work on AI in society and popular culture. And I am your panel chair for this session. My name is Kanta Dihal. I'm a senior research fellow at the Leverhulme Centre for the Future of Intelligence at the University of Cambridge in the UK. So we will first have Despina and then Kate briefly introducing their own work, after which we'll start a discussion to which everybody's questions and views are very welcome in the chat. So first of all, Despina will talk a bit about the interaction between fantasy, history and reality around robots and AI in popular culture. So, Professor Kakoudaki is Professor of Literature, Film and the History of Science and Director of the Humanities Lab at American University in Washington, D.C. And as well as science fiction and apocalyptic stories, her diverse research focuses include this particular interest, the depiction of robots and cyborgs in literature and film. And it's that topic that she explores in her wonderful book from 2014, Anatomy of a Robot, Literature, Cinema, and the Cultural Work of Artificial People, which I wholeheartedly recommend to everyone. And Despina, over to you.
Hello, everyone. It's good to see you. Can everybody hear me okay?
I can, thank you.
Thanks for inviting me for this great topic. And I have just a couple of things to start with, partly because of the constant confusion that we have about terms and about the interaction of fantasy and reality when it comes to robots. And I wanted to share my screen just for a few slides that will show you a little bit how the robotic fantasy works. So let me do that right now. Just a second, hold on. Just a second, actually, why doesn't it work now? Think about it. The idea of the robot for me is always related to embodiment. And as a result, the notion that we have fantasies, emotional fantasies, sexual fantasies about robots feels relevant precisely to what the figure is doing. It is exploring different forms of embodiment for us. I seem to not be able to share my screen. I don't know if there is some kind of, hold on.
It's working, we see your screen.
What do you see now?
Your desktop with, okay. With what is robot.
Ah, okay, but, so if you can see that, then that's fine. Okay, thank you.
Now again, yeah, now, okay. Now it starts again, thank you.
All right, I'm sorry about that. So I wanted to start from this question of what the figure and the name, the idea, the fantasy of the robot includes. And I have a couple of questions in the beginning about clarifying our terms. So when I ask a child, for example, if you ask a child to draw a robot, they will draw something like this. It's a very simple figure. It connects the anthropomorphic and the mechanical. And this figuration of imagining anthropomorphic figures that have a mechanical component is really fascinating in culture and is very commonplace. You can find it in toys, you can find it in folk art. And in fact, all you need in order for that to work is some very, very loose notion of the human figure. Any stick figure, a little dot with a little line could create a face. And we're actually very flexible about what we recognize as anthropomorphic. We recognize the human face in cars and in plugs on the wall and in objects that are made out of assemblages of parts. If I ask a kid to draw a robot, what they will draw is closer to a symbolic robotic figuration like Asimo in Disneyland. And they will never draw for me right now the reality of robots as they are in the marketplace and as they are in factories around the world. So this is two versions of Honda robotics. One is functional. And in fact, in the robot systems that create cars in these huge automated factories are described and designed as ecosystems, where everything is combined and connected to flow and to create the assembly line of the cars. Whereas on the other hand, we have a symbolic version of the robot, which isn't a robot at all. It isn't self-moving, it isn't self-programming. It is remote controlled by two teams of operators. And it basically has one main job, which is to do public relations. And as public relations, these symbolic robots are very useful. If I show you other types of robots that are real, you will see that they don't have any of the aura or the mystique or the anthropomorphic obsessions of the fictional robots. So these are palletizing robots that have transformed how factories and distribution centers and fulfillment centers are working. They are at work everywhere. These are robots that work in biotechnology, and they have absolutely transformed that technology because they are in fact perfect for it. You need to take 1,000 little pipettes in a very clean, very cold environment, shake them and move them to another location. But if I ask a child to draw a robot, they would never draw this, right? The robots that are on Mars, for example, some of my favorites, are another type of ego projection where we say we are on Mars. We don't say the robots are on Mars. We say we are on Mars, and they are functional, and they are they have completely outperformed their initial design. So the real robots and the symbolic robots are operating in a similar environment. And sometimes the confusion we have is that even real robotics, real innovations in technology are described in words and concepts that borrow from the fictional vocabulary, from the fictional landscape. So the realm, kind of like the universe that has been associated with that in fiction, is a universe that is very dependent on types of embodiment. So if you have a robot, for example, I don't know if you can see my cursor, but like Robbie the robot right here, slightly oversized, mechanical, metallic, it shows you its metallic or mechanical body, stilted in its body language and in its language use. You have Commander Data, let's say here, who is an android in the classical vocabulary, human looking, but with some specific difference, like it might be the skin tone, it might be the body language, it might be the inability to understand human culture. You have cyborgs like the Terminator, for example, or Seven of Nine in Battlestar Galactica, who are completely human looking and pass for human. And the language of passing, the language of a kind of a race referent for robotic embodiment is very relevant and very important. And by acquiring this human exterior, by acquiring skin, let's say, they also become undetectable and as a result, more dangerous, right? It is because they can be considered human that they get to have this incredible dangerous performance in culture. In addition, however, because they look completely human, they acquire whatever a particular culture considers to be skin effects. So skin effects might be related to race and ethnicity. They might be related to gender. And in fact, the dangerous robot of fiction, which often becomes very gendered and is often in gendered versions of labor and of fantasy, comes as an outcropping, an outcome of the ability of these specific human-looking robots to pass for human. So they land into the human and they land in completely prescribed gender and stereotype patterns. And then you have things that are, let's say, an AI, which would be an algorithm in my schema, which is following embodiment rather than general terms, which does not have a body. And this thing here that looks like it's on a cell phone is from the movie called Lucy. It doesn't have a body, and as a result, the AI can be anywhere, everywhere. And so the AI is basically a computer program that is not embodied in the world. There is a lot of neologism in those vocabularies, but if you follow what happens with body type, you can see that there is a kind of a variability in what type of artificial person you might need for particular things. So very often people talk about the robots becoming real. But the real robot is always in competition. The real robot here, Roomba, the robot that can vacuum your floor, is always in competition with the fiction and the aura of the robot, which actually it does not replace and it does not challenge. The fiction always wins. The fiction is always stronger than the reality of whatever robots we will make. Like, for example, the robots on Mars do not undermine what kind of robot a little kid would draw for me, which stays quite stable. And we have real robotics inspiring applications, inspiring movies. And we also have versions of robotics that have the same patterns that they have had for hundreds of years. This is a slide of my book. And what I did in the book is I tried to think about ancient and modern ingredients of this discourse. And one of the most ancient ingredients of this discourse is that artificial people are born adult. And so that you have a person that arrives adult into aliveness or into society is the precondition for arriving then to a particular job and arriving to a particular adult body with all of its adjacent possibilities, arriving into prescribed gender roles, and then being treated through this very purposeful and directed vocabulary. It is born adult in order to step into adult positions, and those adult positions include sexuality. And the discourse then is very bifurcated after that point. Artificial men are often imagined as artificial soldiers, workers, or slaves. Artificial women are imagined as sex objects, perfect wives, perfect partners. In other texts, as both perfect partners and perfect weapons, that they are dangerous and their sexuality is part of the danger that they pose. This is a little bit of a diagram of how to understand how these figures work. For me, the reason I called the book Anatomy of a Robot is because we're always trying to look inside these figures. And I was also trying to look inside the discourse of the robot. And so that's why the opening of the face, opening the head, opening these beings. And that idea of opening something or looking inside, being able to see inside, is something that's really very consistent in the discourse, where we are always fascinated by what's inside these bodies, how to get inside these bodies. I have a lot more possible slides, but I'll stop here so that we can get started. I just wanted to clarify a few of the terms for the beginning of our discussion.
Thank you very much, Despina. And then on to Kate Devlin. Dr. Kate Devlin will be discussing a bit more about the reality of where things are today, following on from what we have just seen in the film. So Kate is a lecturer in social and cultural artificial intelligence at King's College London. And her research area is the interaction between cognition, sexuality, and intimacy with artificial intelligence, which is also the subject of her amazing book, Turned On: Science, Sex, and Robots, from 2018, which likewise I would recommend to everyone, especially as it's a very general audience, but you don't need an academic background to fully take everything away from it. Kate, over to you.
Thanks, Kanta. Okay, so I wasn't going to initially do pictures, and then I thought maybe I should show some. So I'm going to try and share my screen as well without having practice. So let's see if I can do this. The excitement. Okay.
Oh, courageous.
I know.
Let's see if it's going to work.
But will it work? Let's see. Okay, yes, we can see that. That's great. I think you can see that. It's a headline. And the headline is from a tabloid newspaper in the UK from a few years ago, from The Express. Now, The Express is known for doing very salacious headlines that don't always bear a close resemblance to the truth. And this one says, "End of sex, scarily real sex robots to replace women as men can't tell the difference." I think it's a very unfair headline on men who are perfectly able to tell the difference. And here is why. So I want to show you a bit of the reality of what's actually out there. So there aren't really any sex robots available. There are prototypes of sex robots, and they tend to be from companies that make sex dolls and love dolls, which are these life-sized, expensive, sort of high-end, almost like kind of advanced crafted, handcrafted mannequins almost of women figures. So if I advance the slides, there we go. So this is actually the state of the art in sex robots. So on the left is a Roxy True Companion. That's a triple X in the Roxy. And Roxy was first emerged on the scene around maybe 10 years ago. And her creator said, you know, I'm taking loads, hundreds, thousands of orders for Roxy. Now, Roxy's never seen the light of day. We don't know if there is actually a finished version out there, because no one's ever said that they have one. So we think it was a bit of a hardware dead end. But Roxy was greeted with sort of howls of laughter when she, and I do gender them when I'm talking about them, when she first appeared on a TV screen. Roxy is essentially a sex doll that has voice that can say things, basically. So nothing moves. It's just like having a mannequin on a sofa who will say things like, "Ooh, I really want you," in a kind of unconvincing way. Anyway, bit of a dead end, Roxy. And then on the right hand side is Samantha. Samantha is a kind of, it is a a sex doll. But the person who created Samantha, Sergio Santos, he wasn't interested in the body. For him, it was the AI that was interesting. So he used a standard sex doll body and he built his own AI system. And he wanted it to be a reciprocal system so that if you wanted to become intimate with Samantha, you had to woo her. You had to court her and say nice things to her. And in return, she would be kind back to you. Sergi has stopped making these dolls. There was a bit of fuss in the media about one of them that was, the paper said molested at a trade show, but actually it was just basically a lot of people handling and touching the doll led to some damage. It wasn't sexually motivated damage. It wasn't done maliciously. It was just this artifact being subject to the touch of thousands of people. But anyway, it's led now to that being put to one side, that project. So in the center is the closest contender to a real world sex robot, and that is Harmony. Harmony is created by Abyss Creations, who make Real Doll. And Harmony is from the neck down, is a doll from the neck down, but has an animatronic head. And the head can turn and blink and smile. It's really quite good. And, I went to visit Harmony when she was being prototyped, and I was really impressed by the craft that went into it. Harmony has an AI personality, and it can be a standalone personality. So you don't need the robot. You can have the AI chatbot version as an app on your phone or tablet. And for $20, you can have this virtual girlfriend that you can talk to. Now, again, heavily gendered. There is a male version called Henry, but Henry has not got the chatbot version yet, because they've said themselves that they would have to make it say different things. So it's already the gendered conversation is very interesting. And Henry is essentially a male sex doll, which is not in quite an advanced state. And I get the kind of impression that Henry's been a bit of a token gesture when people say, but why are there no male versions of these sex robots? So that is it. There's companies in China that are also, there's one or two companies in China that are building these, again, using the sex doll as a basis and building in animatronics and robotics too. Don't have any pictures of those, I'm afraid. So this is a close-up of Harmony again. So you can see this very reductive, stereotypical female form, because of course, if you're going to buy a sex doll, you want your sex doll to meet the criteria of sexy and beautiful. And so this is why we see this being perpetuated. Now there hasn't been a huge amount of research into who will buy these things. And the expectation is it's the same people who would be buying the dolls. And there's been lots of really interesting conversations going on with that community and people who are, asking questions about what would it mean to have one of these dolls? And if you look at one of these robots, if you look on the website for Abyss Creations, they sell this in an incredibly romantic way. So sex is really downplayed and the companion aspect is really pushed. And the idea being that you have this perfect partner who is there to be someone there for you emotionally, not just for sexual pleasure. And it's with the dolls themselves. So people who buy dolls and collect these dolls, not all of them are buying them for the purpose of sex. That may be a secondary purpose, but many people are buying them because they like to collect beautiful things, because they photograph them and pose them and model them, because they want to play out an idea of a relationship with the dolls, or because they have a fetish for them. There are many different reasons. So it's interesting that the companionship element is being so pushed. Is there something intrinsic in the form? Do they have to look like a human to give that idea of companionship, to fulfill that idea of emotional ties? Because if it was just for pleasure, perhaps it wouldn't have to look human at all. And there are also these virtual examples that Despina touched upon as well. So if you think about the film Her, this is a similar thing where you've got the virtual, this is the real doll one on the top left. And then there's also things like Gatebox, which is a personal holographic girlfriend. And so you have these ways of having that companionship without the physical element. And to me, this makes much more sense for a future for sex and technology, because it doesn't have the problematic element of trying to make human-like robots, which are incredibly difficult to make. And it's cheaper, it's easier, and you're still getting that same kind of attachment. So why do they have to look human at all? Well, back in 2016 and again in 2017, I ran some hackathons in London to try and play around with sex tech to make things that weren't human looking. What could you do to take away this idea that things had to resemble existing forms of relationships that we're familiar with? Perhaps we could have sex toys or even bits of technology to do with intimacy and sensuality that didn't depend on the human form. And there were some really, really lovely examples that came out of that. And I'll just have a few little movement ones here. So in the top left corner here, this little GIF, you can see some tentacles that were made from soft robotics, from silicon. And you could put those anywhere on your body and they would curl and flex around the skin and sort of touch and grab you. And again, this is it's not gender specific. It's not directly sexual like a sex toys might be. This could be used anywhere in the body. And then on the right hand side, there's a GIF of a paper fan opening. This was driven by moisture sensors on a vaginal egg, so that when there was a vaginal arousal, the fan would open to indicate that it was an external indication of arousal that is missing in many aspects. So you can tell if someone with a penis is aroused, you can't necessarily tell outwardly if it's a vagina. So this was this really nice idea of saying, how can we shake up what our bodies do and explore this in different ways? And there were some really lovely examples, including a blanket with sensors in that you could put around you. And if you went into a virtual environment and you saw rose petals fall from the ceiling, you would feel them all hitting your skin with the sensors in the blanket. So there's so much we can do. We have the technology to do really exciting and fun things. We have biofeedback. We have things that measure your skin responses and your muscle movement. So yeah, why aren't we making more use of this and disrupting this narrative that a sex robot has to look like a woman, like a large-breasted, thin-waisted woman? Because we can do so much better. And if I can name my Roomba, if I can give my vacuum cleaner a name and watch it scurry around the floor and feel attached to it, you know, it doesn't need to look human for us to form those attachments. We're social creatures, and that social expression is enough for us. So let me just stop sharing my screen. And we can talk more about all of this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kate. So a wonderful start to our panel. I've also been asked to introduce very briefly my own research, just to give a little context about where I am coming from and where some of my questions tonight are coming from. And that particularly has to do with the research that I have done in collaboration with Stephen Cave here in Cambridge on artificial intelligence and race, and particularly on the way in which these embodied robots, particularly the more human-like a robot is being made to look, a fictional or a real one, the more they are made to look like specific kinds of humans, and in particular white humans. Now you can see that's particularly strongly in images from fiction, so like the many examples that we have seen today. So for example, the three humanoid robots in fiction that Despina showed from Star Trek, The Terminator and Caprica, but also, for example, in stock images. So whenever you open a newspaper and there is a story about anything from drone technology developments to fintech and blockchain and anything that has roughly the label AI on it, is very likely to have this very specific white plastic male android attached to it. There's a small range of stock images that are recycled particularly often. And so all of these are racially and ethnically white, creating this really strong link between what kind of machines and therefore what kind of humans we expect to embody intelligence and capability and the ability to be able to do anything, because that is what is being implied with these being humanoid AI, that they can do anything a human can do and better. And so that's where you get narratives like Terminator, where the AI is super strong and is a super killing machine and gets stronger and more intelligent and more versatile in every new Terminator film. But at the same time, those stories are about the robot fitting in. So as Despina said, passing as human and passing as the specific kind of human of whom no questions are asked if they prowl on the streets at night, looking like they might be out up to no good, as Arnold Schwarzenegger in the first Terminator film. But also in Ex Machina, as Despina showed us, the protagonist AI is a white woman who then escapes out into the world. And the idea is that she will be able to pass unnoticed among humans. And that is a threat because she's not actually human. But it's these ideas of what a kind of human of whom no questions are asked, it looks like, that we really try to probe there. And actually, in the most recent Terminator film, which otherwise was not received well, but which does do very interesting things around race and gender, the Terminator itself, the machine sent from the future to kill someone, is Mexican, because the story is set in Mexico. So, you know, if you have an average Mexican town and Arnold Schwarzenegger barges in and tries to find someone specific and kill them, that would be he would be found out pretty quickly, but not someone who blends in. So that's very briefly where I'm coming from in my research on fictional depictions of artificial intelligence. But I will now open the floor for discussion. I have plenty of questions to fire at Despina and Kate, but if you have any questions in the audience, then please do let me know in the chat and I will bring them in. So my first question is for both Despina and Kate, is this question about why anthropomorphism and whether I could probe a bit the issue of different kinds of relationships and whether they need anthropomorphism, whether they need a machine that looks like a human if we want to have these kinds of relationship with machines. Because Kate showed you can have all kinds of sex robot technology that doesn't have to look like humans. But what about if we just want friendship, companionship, romantic love with a robot? Then do we need anthropomorphism? As the history of such inventions in fiction seems to suggest, or is it the case that we might also have to broaden our minds to a different range for those kinds of relationships? Despina.
So to me, it feels like the as with everything that is involved in this discourse, it's very difficult to separate the fantasy from the reality. And the anthropomorphic artificial person or the anthropomorphic mechanical person or the anthropomorphic robot has its own life in fiction and in culture that is associated with very specific paradigms. And the video that you showed, the professor was talking about the romantic origins of the science. And the some of the paradigms for that are about exploring what does it mean to be human like in Frankenstein, for example, by imagining a human from whom certain things have been withheld, right? So the monster in Frankenstein asks this very existential question, why am I not accepted? Why am I not human enough? Why am I rejected by everyone? And these questions are really strong in the novel because, in fact, the monster speaks eloquently and behaves as a very educated European gentleman until it becomes really dangerous after his rejection. So the idea that you would invent a character who is so human as to stage human questions in fiction and in culture makes a lot of sense, right? You want that question to be alive, and the existential tendency in the 20th century about artificial people in stories by Philip K. Dick and others, for example, is so strong that we actually absorb the vocabulary of artificiality as a very intimate emotional vocabulary. So for example, I could say, I'm on automatic pilot today. Or like, I feel nothing, or I feel like a robot. So when you say, I feel like a robot, you are projecting something that is not just, it's not just a general feeling of dissatisfaction. It is about being made into an instrument. It's about feeling oppressed by normativity, about becoming automatic in some way that takes away other notions. So the fictional tradition, there are benefits to an anthropomorphic figuration because it accentuates how existential this can be, right? The more human they look, the more they can say, I feel like a human, but I actually know I'm a robot. And they can play with these really amazing existential questions that are even more intense when they look human. In reality, the human form is either, to me, either a fetish or a liability. Right? The Asimov robot that I showed you, all of the technology, the real technology, is in the fact that it is bipedal, that it can move on two legs and navigate gravity and steps and running and the real world. That is fantastic technology, amazing technology. The top of the body is unnecessary. It is only there to conform to the fetish of imagining this figure. So watching just legs walk by, it's totally something that Asimov can do. And in fact, if you look at prototypes of that design, the prototypes are all about waist down bipedal mobility, because it is exactly the kind of thing that a company focusing on mobility like Honda would invest in. And a lot of the applications from that might result in exoskeletons, artificial body parts, artificial legs, things that support your weight in relation to your hips, for example. Helping bipedal humans with a bipedal technology is an amazing innovation. But the top of the body is unnecessary. It is, right, the thing that makes it anthropomorphic as PR, as public relations. If you want to start from function, like what Kate was saying, you don't need the human body at all. So when you add the human body in, it is because you're adding a fetish. You're adding something that you want to participate in the tradition. You can find a lot more pleasure from something that is adapted to your body rather than something that just looks like your body. Right? You know, something that is like a glove looks like a hand only because it enfolds the hand, but it isn't a hand, right? So I think that that's the thing. For me, it feels like the robotic application component, the less it looks like a human, the more functional it is. The human presence there, the human body there, is a liability or a problem or a limit, a real design limit, or a fetish.
I completely agree about the limitations of that, absolutely. And we know just how tricky it is to build human-like robots. They're really technically complex. And we have this uncanny valley effect, which, you know, the more something looks real, but it's not real, the weirder it seems to us, the more uncanny it seems to us, and we don't like it. We start getting fearful of it. So it is a liability indeed. And if we consider how we engage with technology socially every day, I do wonder, you know, why we insist on having these forms, because the slightest hint of animism is enough to make us believe that we can have that social interaction. So back in the 1960s, Joseph Eisenbaum built the Eliza chatbot, and there's no AI in Eliza. It just matches patterns, right? So and it's based on a Rogerian psychologist. So it's very, very simple to do. So basically, Eliza would say, how are you? And you would say, I'm a bit sad. And Eliza would say, tell me more, and say, oh, I had a bad day. What do you mean by a bad day? And it would keep feeding back your own answers to you. But very quickly, people who knew perfectly well that this was not a sentient machine, very quickly people started confiding in this machine, to the point where they did not want Weizenbaum to turn it off or to store the answers, because they were telling this machine, telling this script, this piece of software, some really personal things. So that interaction, And it's been, you know, studied lots down the years, that interaction or semblance of sentience, even when people know that these things aren't sentient, is enough for us to buy into the delusion and run with the delusion. We're not fooling ourselves. We're perfectly aware of it. But we choose to incorporate it into our lives this way because we are social creatures. And that's how we get on with everyone. That's how we get on with each other. So I think that this, you know, we this is why I think the kind of virtual versions of these, I think, are more readily accepted, because our expectations are not as high in the same way that we have expectations set very high for human-like robots. And also the pets and the home robots, a little bit easier. So, you know, I can treat my robot vacuum cleaner like a pet because it scurries around the floor. And that's my expectations of a pet. If I was expecting it to act like a cleaner and walk around moving furniture and cleaning, my expectations would be shattered because it can't do that. So our expectations also play into this too. So this very long-winded way of saying, you know, I think the form, we place too much emphasis on the form. We're seeing this emergence of a social category where we are building social rapport with machines, and we have all these predetermined narratives about what that should look like, but it doesn't have to look like that. And it's we'd be going down the wrong path if we try and replicate humans in an artificial form.
And also it feels like replicating the human is just such an old-fashioned component in this discourse. And as I was saying when I was showing the slides, it's so easy to give an impression of the human form. So easy, two dots and a line. It's immediate because we are so projective. We project immediately, right? So the question is like, many of those fetishistic narratives present reciprocity or reactiveness or ability to understand and respond as fundamental gestures of the human. But my phone has all these things right now. If you install the right technology in your house could be responsive, reactive. It can preempt your needs. It can say you need these groceries. You can program your coffee maker. So all of these active objects, all of these reactive and responsive objects are participating in that vocabulary without needing any of the forms, right? Without needing the human form at all. So as a result, I think we are also changing what we expect from this fiction. What people used to do in imagining like reactivity and relationality are a hallmark of human interaction. Well, my phone is very relational. I can have something that tracks my heartbeat that I wear. So a lot of those objects have so much reactivity, so much relationality, but we don't really project onto them that notion of a human relationship. So it feels to me like when it reaches these points, it's as if we're talking around a particular issue. It is cheaper to use people. So what's the point of this fantasy? Like, would I pay $1 million to buy a very, or $100,000 to buy a sex doll where I could actually have phone sex with someone, or I can hire someone, or I can watch pornography, right? So what is the additional extra that seems to be part of that? It isn't really at all about my satisfaction somehow, because my satisfaction can have other avenues.
Thank you both. And that really brings me to my next question of how the fact that there is this, I guess, fantasy about a sex robot implies an entwinement of the physical and the emotional. And so should we be looking for the gratification of each in different technologies? Or would it be possible to imagine those two ever combining into a single technology? Or would that be misleading, wrong, unethical? And so in the same way, would there ever be, Kate, you emphasized that in the marketing of these prototypes, there was this very strong emphasis on the companionship element. And you use the word the word delusion came up. Whose delusion is being fed here? Who's fooling whom in emphasizing that it's all about the connection, really? It's all about the companionship, really, when they are sex dolls with extras.
Yeah, I think that the companies that are making them, especially Real Doll of His Creations, they're very motivated by the idea that they can provide this companionship. And Matt McMullen, the director of that, the CEO of that, says, you know, this is like a different kind of pet sort of thing. You know, it's that kind of level of companionship that you've got this in your home or whatever. And so people are quite happy to buy into that. And, you know, this is, again, every time I use the word delusion, I don't mean it in a negative way. It's more of a fantasy, more of a parasocial relationship where they're going, the same way that I might love someone in a film or, you know, in a book, you get this attachment and then you can build your whole fantasy world around it. And if you think of things like fan fiction, there are universes out there, you know, people have built their own alternative universes about characters that they love. So it's really another form of that. It's projecting your dreams and your hopes and your pleasures onto this piece of technology.
Despina?
If people are interested in this connection with projection, a movie that came out a few years ago called Robot and Frank is a wonderful, wonderful film for this question. An elderly man is losing his memory and his son gets him a robot to clean the house and make sure that he takes his medicine. And it's a beautiful contrast because the man is losing his memory and the robot has perfect memory. But the man used to be a jewel thief when he was younger. And so he starts training the robot to break into houses. And it's very clear, however, in the movie that the relationality is starting from this man. It's starting from his projections, from his desires, from his needs. The robot never becomes a gothic or romantic robot of arriving into a different type of consciousness. The robot has perfect programming and performs this programming, which is to take care of this person and to participate in whatever way is possible to his desires. So there's something about that movie that I think already captures the fact that we know a little bit more about how real robotics would work and how real projects would work, that they would not just be suddenly sentient in a way that breaks programming and design limits. But the fact that the movie has such a strong human core that you can see the problem with memory, perfect memory and imperfect memory, but also the problem of projection and friendship, how they become friends, it is because this man has the capacity for friendship. And so I think that very often when we have these conversations, we are still looking at the human participant. What is the projection of fantasy that they are making onto the object? What do they think they're getting mirrored back from that object? And in my personal view, it doesn't really, like, people are extremely loyal to objects. You lose one of your pair of earrings and you keep the other one in a drawer. We keep broken things because we're attached to them. This projection into objects, it is part of what we do as humans. We project out into the natural world and into things we hold and touch and are intimate with in our bodies. So to me, it feels like something about the sadistic fantasy that is going on with imagining the sex toy or the sex doll or the sex objects. It's as if you're treating them in a slightly different way as objects that you will not project into the way you might project into your car. And so that's why the human form is a liability. It makes those objects more vulnerable because you will abuse them rather than taking care of them the way you take care of your car or your lost earring. Your lost pair of an earring. So there's something to me about the strange triangulation of desire, of wanting a human companion without any responsibility, and instead with the fantasy of being able to treat this person as disposable, or treat this person as non-essential, or treat this person as an object. And so whenever there's a discussion like this that hits these very complicated emotional and projective relationships, usually what I do is I go back to what is the human doing? And it is a liability. Like, for example, we see that in the TV series Westworld. At some point, it isn't about what the artificial people are suffering. It is about what kind of person are you that you want to enact this violence on someone? Whether or not that person is real in your category, it doesn't matter. Your ability to project that kind of violence, that's the liability. That's the problem, right? The fact that you think that you can treat anything this way, precisely because you would not treat your car this way. So it feels like if you want to think about the ethics, you have to start back on what the human is doing. What are the human tendencies there?
Absolutely. Thank you both. We have an audience question, which is, have I gotten the right impression that you generally don't see getting attached through a robot as problematic? I'm a bit surprised because the usual discourse tends to focus on robots binding the human capacities for relationships and therefore making people neglect true mutual relationships.
Yeah, I have no problem whatsoever in seeing that people can get attached to technology. And it actually surprises me when people do say, oh, you can't do that, it will ruin human relationships. I don't see that. We are very, very good as humans of having relationships, forming relationships with other humans. We're kind of primed instinctively to do that. But I think that if you start viewing it as a replacement or a surrogate relationship or something that is identical to a human relationship, I think that's misleading, because it's not. It's something new in its own right. And the closest comparison we have is of like a pet, or, you know, it's a creature that you look after, because this is something where the human is in control. So you could think of it that way. Kate Darling's written a book called The New Breed that looks at animals and the way we treat animals and the way we treat robots. But I don't see a problem. And, you know, there's been lots of really interesting research done. Julie Carpenter in the US has done amazing work about military robots and the way that soldiers become very attached to bomb disposal robots, to the point where they will, you know, they're telling stories about how they held funerals for these robots when they were destroyed in battle. So, you know, is there a problem with that? I don't think there is. And, you know, I very much have say if someone finds some comfort through this, and it's not damaging, and I have not seen evidence to suggest that this kind of thing is damaging, these conversations, then I think that's a good thing. The ways I would worry is if we start, you know, the government starts saying, oh, well, we don't need carers anymore, we'll just give someone a robot to talk to all day, and then slashes the budget to fund healthcare. You know, that would worry me. But the independence and the fight against loneliness and isolation that these could potentially have, I think, is really powerful. And I wouldn't dismiss it as being problematic, because I think a lot of people could really enjoy this.
Despina, what do you think?
I love that you gave healthcare as an example, because that's often what comes up. It's like there are often these imaginary scenarios of artificial soldiers, artificial carers, robot nurses, robot doctors. And I have the feeling that the government would treat an artificial soldier that costs $2 million a little differently than how it treats human soldiers, which is very badly. And we often have, again, a kind of a bizarre idea that an artificial body that has plug-in body parts, replaceable body parts, would be easier to service and easier to replace than the human body, which regenerates every single day, right? Like, the human body is actually miraculous in its capacities. No machine can be that complicated. And so the fetishism of imagining that if you had replaceable body parts, I mean, I understand it. It would be so great to have a new liver. It would be great to plug it in. It would be so great. But the way that the body responds to injury or to illness, it is unbelievable, unfathomable in its complexity, and no machine can even come a millionth close to what that is. So we have this strange idea that a body with replaceable parts would be so much easier, cleaner, easier to replace. Like, how are you going to do maintenance to this artificial soldier whose power, you know, power thing just won't ever start again? Whereas a very tired human soldier will start again and will get up out of survival instinct, if not loyalty to their own troops. So there's something about that. But the healthcare question is I think something that comes up a lot, because it is really clear that there is an employment crisis in healthcare, and also a kind of an aging global population. I'm not really sure that the robotics will be the answer there. Remote medicine might be, right? So we are seeing things that are, again, like drones, for example, to deliver medicine or blood supplies in places that don't have reliable roads. That is an application that I can really see transforming medical technology. Being able to do advice through telemedical possibilities that have robotic endings. So robotic endings meaning a remote operation that could happen. It doesn't take away the human factor and the human doctor. And I think that actually, especially after the year we've had with COVID, where so much has been online, I think people crave human contact and human companionship in a way that affects us very differently now. It's not enough to live everything through the screen. So I think that there will be some revaluation of that.
Well, that's something to end our panel, which is entirely virtual, on today. Although I think this shows perfectly how we, on the one hand, have been able to bring in together a very internationally based group virtually. But on the other hand, it does make me realize, Kate, I have met in person, but Despina, I do hope we will get the chance in future. And that brings us to the end of our panel already. I can't believe that the hour has just flown by, thanks to my two excellent panelists, Kate Devlin and Despina Kakoudaki. Please join me in thanking them. And thank you for having all three of us at the festival. Enjoy your evening.
Thank you, Kanta.
Thank you.
Kate. Bye. Thank you, Han.